I get a lot of messages from med students, residents, attendings, asking me about balancing entrepreneurship with clinical duties. So if you want to work in healthcare and have a side hustle, stay tuned. What's going on, guys? For those of you who are new here, my name is Kevin Jabal. I graduated with my MD in 2017, mashed into plastic surgery, and I quit. I'm now doing full-time entrepreneurial endeavors, primarily in medical technology and medical education. Now, just because I quit plastic surgery residency does not mean that you need to. I think this is something that is a very personal decision, depends on your goals. I have a whole video on my decision as to why I did that. Now, before diving into the entrepreneurship side, we first need to discuss the medicine side, and that comes down to your specialty choice. Most obviously, you want to consider the time you're working and then the time you have outside of work. There's two main considerations. So first, when you're in medical school, if you're going into something that is more competitive, that's going to require more time studying, you need to be at the top of your class, etc., and you'll have less time to pursue a side hustle. Once you get into residency and as an attending, the actual competitiveness of the specialty is less important. Whether it's surgical or non-surgical becomes much more important. So, for example, if you were applying into something that's less competitive, so emergency medicine, family medicine, anesthesia, then you don't need to be at the top of your class. You can spend more time on a side hustle compared to someone going into derm or plastics or neurosurgery who needs to be at the top of their class to have a serious chance of getting into that residency. But once they're in residency, the derm person, very competitive, and the anesthesia person, not so competitive, they both have very relaxed residencies where they're not working 80 hours a week, they're working 40, 50, maybe 60 hours a week, tops. On the other hand, all the surgical people, whether you're plastics or ortho, you know, very competitive, or general surgery, which is less competitive of the surgical specialties, you're gonna be working really, really challenging hours. Now that applies also to attending life. So the specialties that are more challenging in residency tend to be more challenging as an attending. The average physician in the US works 60 hours per week. If you are surgical, you'll be on the higher end, maybe pushing more than that. Whereas if you're non-surgical, you are more likely to be under that. Now your specialty choice also includes some incentives. First of all, interestingly, you'll see a lot of orthopods that start medical device companies or entrepreneurial ventures because they have such a consistent and high degree of exposure to devices in the operating room. But when it comes to compensation, if you're in a surgical specialty, on average you'll be making more, the financial draw of a side hustle has to be greater to pull you away from your primary career. Meaning, if you were a neurosurgeon making 800 or 900K per year versus a family medicine physician, for your side hustle to make 50K per year, that's gonna mean much more to the family med guy than the neurosurgeon just based on their already existing clinical income. You also need to consider working for a larger group, which is what most people do, or doing private practice as a clinician, which is obviously entrepreneurial. Private practice is generally more work, but you have more flexibility with your hours. You can also make more money. But this all, it's more of a complex equation. It's not very cut and dry. So for example, you may have fixed overhead. Let's say you're working in an aesthetic plastic surgery practice and your fixed overhead is essentially 20 hours of your weekly work. And you normally work 40 to 60 hours. So those extra 20 to 40 hours per week are your pure profit. That's what you take home. But if you wanted to cut that down from 40 hours to 30 hours, so now you're working 3/4 of the hours per week, you're actually taking home only half the amount. Because remember, you're only making money past 20 hours. The other stuff is just covering your base expenses, your fixed overhead. Now, what should your side hustle be? There are infinite options. This will be a very personal decision. I'm gonna make a separate video outlining the whole business map and the various things you can do. But what I will say is that for most people, again, there are a few businesses where this won't make sense, for example, medical technology and other things. But for most people, having a social media following is going to be beneficial. Social media is such a powerful way to build an audience. It's free marketing for your company. I mean, you can do it with your own iPhone. You don't need a, you know, fancy lights or a camera, things like that. You can start with very basic things, and some people will monetize their social media following. So you have most obviously sponsorships, brand deals, but you can also promote your own content, your own courses, your own, you know, learning products, your own services. So for most people, social media is going to be a net positive. Now, this is normally the part when a lot of people say, oh, you know, I have cold feet, I'm lacking confidence. can I really do this? I don't have an MBA. Look, you don't need a formal degree. You already got into medical school. You are smart enough to do this, trust me. You don't need permission from anyone. You just need to dive in and start. Experiential learning is gonna be way more powerful than sitting in the classroom, going through textbooks, etc. I'm not saying that you should just dive in without any knowledge. Do some basic research on the area you're looking at, but you can do that with the internet. You can do that with books. You can do that with forums. You don't have to get a formal degree first. In fact, when I was working on Bluelink, the biomedical incubator where we help people create healthcare startups with medical devices, I had a couple mentors tell me, Kevin, are you considering getting an MBA? Don't do it. I wasn't considering getting an MBA, but they were so adamant that I should not get an MBA that they would go out of their way to tell me not to get one. The reason being is that once you're at that stage, you're gonna learn way more by just doing rather than, you know, if I was looking for a promotion at a healthcare administration kind of position or, you know, in some other business role, okay, an MBA would pad my resume. But if I'm trying to start my own businesses, there's so much more value in me just doing it. And at this point, you may be thinking, yeah, but I'm gonna make mistakes. It's gonna be scary. It's gonna be costly. Look, you'll make mistakes. In my first year of business, I made a costly, close to $1,000 mistake, but I learned the lesson and I survived, okay? So you don't have to be perfect. It's gonna be okay. Some people have these big lofty goals, you know, Elon Musk changing the world. You don't have to be Elon, just start small. You know, before SpaceX, he was doing PayPal. And okay, PayPal was still a really big thing, but for us mere mortals, you don't need to start with some super grand vision of building a company and then exiting, selling it for hundreds of millions of dollars like he did with PayPal, right? You can start with something small, learn from that experience, and then build from there. You wanna make the goals more internal than external. So even if the business failed by traditional means, so if it didn't make money, if the business, you know, didn't last more than, you know, whatever period of time you want it to last, make the goal less external and more internal so that at the end of the day, you still come out ahead. Meaning, even if the business fails by traditional means, so the business doesn't last, it's not profitable, you're losing money, et cetera, you are still learning skills. You're developing your personal and professional network. You are learning public speaking, you're learning marketing, you're learning various skills and strategies and tactics that are going to serve you in your future endeavors, whether that's clinically as a physician or whether that's with your new business endeavor in the future. And remember, you don't have to quit your day job to do this. The way I see it is you can do anything, you just can't do everything. If you want to start 3 businesses and be a serial entrepreneur, you probably can't also be an effective plastic surgeon at the same time. But if you want to be a surgeon while having, you know, one side hustle that is more manageable, then that's probably feasible. So for most people, stick to med school, stick to residency, stick to being an attending, but then work on this consistently on the side and give it enough time. Don't think that after 1 month you're gonna be super profitable and off to the races. Understand it's a long process. And the most important thing is consistency and working intelligently. Because if you just work hard and grind it out week after week, but you're putting your energy on the wrong things and not doing things, not experimenting, not questioning your own assumptions, you can waste a lot of time and a lot of money in that process. But if you are consistent and working smart, you're very likely to come out ahead. Now let's talk big picture risk buckets. Finances and investing are, you need to understand these core foundational areas before you start making money, not after. I recommend you read a few finance books. My favorites were The White Coat Investor and probably The Bogleheads Guide to Investing. I'm gonna have a link to those and a few others down in the description. But beyond that, let's think bigger picture, these risk buckets. So most MDs have a very safe and stable income stream. Being a clinician for most specialties is usually very much in demand, and regardless of what's happening with the economy, it's up or down, you have a stable job, you're making good money. So with that very safe bucket, you can rely on that. I mean, you should still have disability insurance because if you can't do that anymore, then you're kind of screwed. That means that with the other bucket, you want to have a balance here. With the safe bucket, you can now balance out a riskier bucket. So with your investments, you can be a little bit riskier. You don't have to be as conservative if you already have a very safe primary income. Whereas on the other hand, if your main income stream is entrepreneurial, very risky because most businesses fail. So for example, for me, I don't have anything clinical now. That primary source of income is higher risk, then your investment bucket should be safer. It should be more conservative. And for me, what I do is broad index funds. I don't stock pick. I mean, I've done it like once or twice with a very small amount of money, but for the most part, 90 whatever percent of my portfolio is in broad index funds. I do VTSAX and VTIAX. Again, that's what I do. This is not financial advice. I'm not a financial advisor, but the way I see it is that this is much more safe, it's conservative, it's kind of boring, but in the long run, it's gonna be a safe bet. Now, the other thing to consider is the ROI on your time and energy. So if you have a huge nest egg, you got 10 mil, 20 mil in your investments, then yeah, optimizing your investments here and there, trying to squeeze out a few basis points is gonna result in a substantial monetary difference at the end of the year, at the end of whatever time frame. Whereas if you are like me, you're early on in your career, you would have a much higher ROI if you focus on building your business, building your income streams, becoming a better med student, a better resident, a better attending, building that, and then doing lazy investing where you do index funds and you're getting 80, 90% of the returns with 0% of the work. I literally just have auto invest set up every week from my bank account to my Vanguard account, and I don't do anything. It just automatically deposits every single week. And the reason this is so important is that I can free up energy from investing and put it all towards currently Med School Insiders and MEM primarily. And then when you're further along, when you have a bigger nest egg, then you can start optimizing your individual investments. Now last, let's talk about these get rich quick schemes, and in short, stay away. Essentially, these people are saying that they're gonna teach you how to make money, but in reality, they're primarily making money off of selling a course rather than actually making money doing the thing that they say they're gonna teach you how to do. You see this a lot in the Amazon FBA space. Do your research, go on Reddit, read customer reviews. A lot of people are very unhappy with the courses they buy. There may be like one or two guys that consistently have at least decent reviews. Now, true entrepreneurial success doesn't come easy. People want the shortcut, the follow this easy formula, A plus B equals C. It's not like that, man. If you want a true, robust, sustainable business, you can't just buy a course and learn how to do it. You have to actually experiment and learn and think intelligently and, you know, read different books, try different strategies. When you're such a small downstream player, small changes in the policies or in SEO or competition or, you know, inventory and product supplies, they can wreak havoc on your business model. It's not robust enough. Whereas if you put in the time and energy to build something that's more sustainable long-term, more robust, that's gonna be a little more anti-fragile even. First of all, it's very rewarding, but long-term there's a much higher ceiling and the chances that it's gonna endure for the long-term is also much greater. If you found this video useful, I have a whole Surge into Entrepreneur playlist that you may also like. Much love, and I will see you guys in that next one.